Alban Resources Limited is a gold exploration company with significant projects in British Columbia, Saskatchewan, and the Yukon. Trading on the TSX Venture Exchange, symbol ABN, and the pink symbol ABNAF. Surrounded by world-class gold deposits and mines, Alban's 23,000 hectares Forest Kerr Gold Project is located in the heart of the Golden Triangle in northwestern BC. For more information, visit us at albanresources.com.
You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at talkdigitalnetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Danielle Park, editor of the popular blog Juggling Dynamite and president of Venable Park Investment Council Incorporated. Welcome back to the show, Danielle.
Thank you, Jim.
Danielle, Stats Canada says it won't publish its February 5th trade report due to the U.S. government shutdown. Is that starting to affect business in Canada?
Well, that report, I think, is... It's always backward-looking anyway, so they may have to estimate or skip one of their estimates until they get some better data. I don't see that as being particularly pivotal in any way. We know that inflation, in fact, has been falling, both because energy prices were coming down, but also because companies have been, you know, having to reduce prices in some regard when consumption has been falling in the past couple of years. So there isn't a great deal, well, there's certainly not wage pressure per se, and the other parts of consumer goods have been relatively tame. So I don't think that anyone's really that concerned about the rate of inflation in Canada at the moment.
Something I really noticed on your blog, everything electric when it comes to cars and trucks. Is the electric future of the automobile getting a lot more prominent now?
Well, it's because the Detroit Auto Show, which is, of course, one of the world's biggest auto shows, is this week. And I just couldn't help but notice the change in the leaders of the other, you know, traditional car makers who are attending. I can remember, you know, even a couple or 3 years ago, people scoffing at Tesla and its ambitions to build the world's best car, never mind the world's best electric car, and a lot of people saying, you know, that it was never going to possibly happen, or, you know, it was a pie in the sky. And this year, you can't help but notice that all the major car brands are sort of rushing to roll out their new ideas, and they are very, very far behind Tesla in terms of its product and production and just the incredible quality of what it makes. And, you know, all the major heads are now basically, you know, there's a, in interviews, they're all mentioning Tesla as the benchmark. How do we catch up? How do we, you know, roll out our EVs fast enough because consumers are wanting them? And, you know, so things like the Mercedes, you know, has promised to bring its all-electric SUV to North America by 2020 is the projection. And, of course, people are saying, is this a Tesla killer? And that's really missing the point. First of all, because Tesla is, the quality of what they've produced is not just pie in the sky or promised, it's actually delivered, and it's won all the awards for the best car companies in the world. So they've already delivered. Second of all, Mr. Musk gave away the patents, let's not forget, in 2014 to help these other companies catch up because he was so concerned about them being so far behind and he wanted competition in the marketplace. So this has been a huge help to getting them sort of off their laurels and moving forward. You know, the fact that we're getting more competition in product is awesome for consumption and consumers who, you know, not everyone wants to buy a $100,000 high-end vehicle, but the more that the technology evolves, the more product and offerings that are brought forward across all of the different price points, the more the entire sector benefits. And indeed, Ford announced at this week's Detroit Car Show that they are now going to bring forward their best-selling, you know, they sold something like a million F-100 trucks in 2018, and that is their best-selling product, and they're now finally promising to roll out an all-electric version of this in the not too distant future. So they're finally getting, you know, the penny's finally dropping that this is the way of the future. This is the product everybody's wanting, and no one's giving up on performance or quality or any of that to get these cars and vehicles. But what we are giving up on is the nasty stuff like emissions and air pollution and all the stuff that we don't want to have. The challenge, of course, is that the common business model or the dominant business model right now is that the auto industry makes the bulk of its money from not only the most expensive vehicles, the SUVs and the trucks, but also from the maintenance programs and all the parts that need to be replaced and repaired and looked after over time. And of course, that's where most of the dealers get the bulk of their revenue these days. Now, when you move to an electric vehicle platform, there's a fraction of the parts for first of all, so there's much less maintenance and care and upkeep. And so many of the dealer models will not be sustainable in their current form. So the challenge to the industry is not just to roll out the, you know, EV products that are of a good quality. They seem to have finally got that memo, and they're scrambling to do that. The next challenge, of course, though, is how do they sustain their current distribution center of dealers who are dependent upon all the things that go wrong with the ICE engine vehicles. And we're not clear yet on how that. I'm thinking to myself, this must be like the transition from the horse and buggy and all the horse whip makers and things that were dependent upon that old form of transportation when the vehicle came in, the gas-powered vehicle came in, many of them were no longer viable, and they had to transition to different jobs or different sectors, or the companies had to find new business models. And I think that's exactly what's happening right now.
Well, Hilliard Macbeth, one of my regular guests, was complaining to me one day about the high cost of the tune-ups he needed for his Mercedes-Benz. And I said, if you had an electric car, you don't need tune-ups. The only thing you have to worry about is topping up your windshield wiper fluid. So now his family has two Teslas. And he said, you're absolutely right. You have to have the batteries checked once a year.
Absolutely. And, you know, a lot of people very rightly say, you know, people can't afford to have two Teslas. Most people can't, especially if they're trying to live without debt. You know, an interesting stat, just as a sidebar, is that 85% of the vehicles in North America are financed either through leases or loans. So this is a highly aspirational product, which most people can't afford to buy just on a regular level. And you'd think maybe that the most highest income earners buy their vehicles cash, and the reality is they don't. The highest income earners tend to buy the more expensive products and change them up every 2 or 3 years for whether it's prestige or vanity or whatever it is, or just because they have the cash flow and think they can afford it. But the truth is very few people pay, you know, for a vehicle in full without having to take on financing, which is typically a bad financial move because it is just a depreciating asset. Now, when you get to something like an electric car, certainly a Tesla, it typically holds its value more. So I think, you know, the first thing we all need to do is try and drive less, try and take, you know, public transport where it makes sense so you can be more efficient, you can do work, and you don't have to worry about driving in traffic. And the second thing is, you know, walk, ride bikes, you know, do whatever you can to help your physical health, but also just to avoid needing, you know, a vehicle of any kind. But when you do need a vehicle, obviously the transition to individual transportation towards electric is the way to go. And also with that, you know, people have to try and figure out a way to maintain their fiscal health. So the challenge is, how do we get, you know, where people absolutely need to buy a vehicle, how can they do it in a cost-effective manner that doesn't require them to take on car payments for 8 and 9 years? You know, because although they may be able to pay that out of their cash flow, the reality is they are not able to save that money for things like retirement or education of their children because they're constantly paying out these payments. So this is the brave new world into which we must go after the debt bubble, where I say that people are going to be much less tolerant of household debt, not only because they are at all-time highs, but also because rates have moved higher, right? So, you know, I was just looking at that. The prime rate in Canada, which is the base rate, it is influenced by the Bank of Canada's overnight rate. It moves with that, and the banks typically add a premium onto the base rate from the Bank of Canada's overnight rate to set their own prime. But just as a point of reference, you know, the prime rates, even in 2017, not that long ago, Jim, was 2.7 in Canada. And, you know, as of today, it's up to 3.95. So what you've got is things like HELCOs, which a lot of people took out these floating rate loans against their home in the past couple of few years to buy things like cars, you know, to put them, roll it onto the mortgage or house. And, the rates that were, you know, they were paying something like, you know, that 2.7 prime plus a half back in 2017, you know, now they're paying things like 4.45 plus a half on HELCOs. So these rates have really got a lot more expensive, just as people's wages have stagnated and just as we're starting to see layoffs again. So all of this has to be balanced. It's quite tricky, but I do think it's a good thing that rates have moved higher, that people are going to understand that nothing is free and that there's no, you know, rolling money out of your house constantly is not going to be available if we have a decade of stagnant or lower prices in housing, which looks like we're headed into. And so it's going to put in and force a fiscal responsibility or discipline on people that they've not had to really do for the past decade. So ultimately, this is all healthy stuff, and the goal for everyone should be to try and get a home they can afford. Now, in you know, ideally, if they can pay for the roof over their head and be mortgage-free, great. But it always depends on the math, because some people are able to rent, you know, a nice places to live in co-ops and things for, you know, a fraction of what it would cost them to have a house with a mortgage and all the maintenance that goes with that. So ultimately, the idea is to have your shelter that allows you to build up savings, to have a vehicle that allows you to build up savings, or to have transportation that allows you to build up savings. So thinking outside the box means that you maybe don't necessarily need to buy a car. You certainly don't need to change your car every 2 or 3 years. It's certainly not a good financial decision to do that. It's certainly in your best interest to pay for the things that you do buy and then, you know, have ability to save. And I think that's the phase that everyone's sort of coming to, is we need to get this debt down. It's going to take us a while, but boy, when we're paid for, we're going to try and be much more prudent with our allocation decisions going forward. And I think that's going to be a positive time.
We'll have more with Danielle Park right after the break.
I'm Douglas Mason, CEO of Naturally Splendid, symbol NSP on the TSX Venture Exchange. Naturally Splendid is a biotechnology and consumer products company focused on the global cannabis and health markets. Naturally Splendid is expanding distribution in this rapidly growing market with products currently in Canada, the USA, South Korea, Germany, and Australia. To view our comprehensive company presentation and for more information, please visit our website at naturallysplendid.com.
MGX Minerals is revolutionizing the new energy economy with patented lithium extraction technology, replacing traditional solar evaporation using low-cost, low-energy nanofiltration. The first system of this paradigm shift technology is currently being commissioned. MGX Minerals trades on the CSE, symbol XMG, the OTCQB, symbol MGXMF, and Frankfurt, symbol 1MG. For more information, visit our website, mgxminerals.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Danielle Park. Danielle, do you expect the federal government is going to start pouring cash off the back of a truck with a federal election just around the corner?
Well, that would be a typical pattern. There's no question they're going to want to try and appease voters in some way. And I think that the pressure to do so will become more intense if the economic data continues to slow down the way it has done in the last year. We've certainly seen a downturn in the Bank of Canada itself. Came out, you know, when it paused and didn't raise rates this month, it cited things like a slowdown in the global economy, and the fact that there's great uncertainty around the future price for oil prices, future path for oil prices. And they, you know, lowered the 2019 GDP forecast for Canada to 1.7%, Jim, down from 2.1. So that's the Bank of Canada, which are perennially pretty optimistic, saying that they see less than 2% growth for Canada in 2019. So this is going to line up kind of uncomfortably, for the Liberal government to, you know, who is trying to get reelected. So this is sort of typical of these election cycles, though. Some people happen to come in at the bottom of a, you know, recession and bear market for financial markets, and they have sort of rosy sailing because coming from the bottom, everything looks better for a few years. And other people are trying to get elected at the very late stages of an economic cycle when asset prices have already begun falling, as they have in Canada, not just in the stock and corporate bond market, but also in the real estate market. Where you've seen pretty precipitous declines in many of the hottest markets around the country. So all these things make it pretty tricky, but the problem is, of course, that at the same time we've got this economy that's become heavily dependent upon things like housing and consumption spending, which have driven the bulk of the growth in the past, you know, 5 years or more. And so, at the same time, that's where a lot of the tax revenue has come from that turnover in the housing sector and related services and things like vehicle sales, which have been falling. You know, vehicle sales are falling all around the world. They're coming into their seventh consecutive monthly drop in places like China, you know, where everyone thinks, oh, they have an insatiable, demand for goods because there's 1.3 billion people. Well, not apparently, because now they're slowing down in their purchases as well. So this is all about the cash crunch that's going on in the world, the global liquidity, which has turned down since 2016. It's a function of the high debt levels. It's a function of the central banks that have been raising rates and trying to withdraw all the excess liquidity. You know, the QEs that they put in, they've been trying to back out of the system. And all that the Bank of Canada and the central bank actions, of course, don't really bite the economy for many quarters. So even the, you know, the hikes that have happened to date, the Bank of Canada blinking this month and saying, ooh, maybe we better pause here at 1.75 as an overnight rate, which is historically extraordinarily low, but they're still afraid to hike further. Why? Because the hikes that they have done to date have barely, because of the lag time, they've barely already, you know, it started to trickle into the overall economy, and already the economy's showing problems and weakness, and you know, consumption, and as I say, is turned down, and things like autos and home sales, some of these key bellwethers of economic progress or economic consumption, let's say. So there's all these things are really coming to a tipping point right in the election year. So I think the problem is that tax revenues are going to get hit here, as well as, you know, an increase in things like demand for government programs, for applications for benefits of various kinds. So this is what always happens at the end of an economic cycle. The expenditures go up and the revenues start to plunge. And, you know, the government has to try and make it look like they have all the answers. And unfortunately, they don't have all the answers because the add, debt, and stir was the only answer that anybody came up with for the last decade. And now we're at the end of that. So really, we need a cleaning phase, a clearing phase. And I think whatever government comes in, they're going to be, you know, 2019 and 20 are looking to be quite challenging years, not only on an economic basis, but fiscally for the government. And if there's a change of government, of course, they'll blame the Liberals, but if the Liberals get back in, they won't have that prerogative of being able to say it was someone else's fault. Really, we're all in this together. It's been bad policies led by central banks and banks who have encouraged people to borrow and spend their brains out, you know, lax lending, all this stuff, which is now in the mean reversion process. So that's good. Rates higher, you know, appetite for debt lower, people wanting to pay things down rather than buy. So this will be a contraction in terms of consumption in the world, which will translate into a difficult economy for some time. But ultimately, it's the phase we must go through to get set up for, you know, having higher savings rates, less debt, and a more robust future. So anyway, that's a long answer, Jim, to your question, but there's a lot of moving parts here.
We'll have more with Danielle Park right after this.
Grand Portage Resources recently completed the 2018 drill program on its 100% controlled Herbert Gold Discovery property located in the prolific Juneau Belt in southeast Alaska. Drill results are expected through late 2018. Past drill results included numerous multi-ounce gold assays on multiple veins. Grand Portage trading symbols are GPG on the TSX Venture, GPTRF on the OTCQB, and GPB on Frankfurt. For more information, please visit our website, GrandPortage.com.
Don't miss out. Stay informed. Receive the HowStreet.com weekly recap with thought-provoking podcasts, radio, and articles delivered to your inbox. Sign up for the HowStreet.com weekly recap on our homepage at HowStreet.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Danielle Park. Danielle, you were looking at some statistics that indicate alcohol consumption in the U.S. is falling.
Yeah, there was a story about that, how, you know, some of the younger generations, or the millennials as they like to call them, are not consuming or not drinking as much as their parents did in terms of, you know, spirits and beer. And there's a sort of an interest or a rise in demand for lower alcohol alternatives, you know, the near beers or the Radlers of the world. And they were just saying how, you know, I was thinking that that's actually quite positive. The other thing is potentially that the sort of modernization or acceptance of marijuana is also coming into that, where more people are thinking that they, you know, will consume marijuana rather than alcohol because they report less side effects and sort of hangovers the next day, that kind of thing. So it's also probably one of the trends that's playing into this. But it's interesting to watch, because right now, you know, the way the concentration of the industry has gone, concentration in industry generally has gone worldwide, all of the competitors, smaller startups, smaller mid-sized businesses have been gobbled up by massive conglomerates. And so you get very little real meaningful choice as a consumer, because you're dealing with, you know, 25 brands under the same mega corporation. And so I think it makes it harder for them than to turn and sort of follow new and emerging trends in consumer tastes. And so they've really doubled down. I think there's two major beer manufacturers now that have gobbled up all these brands, and now they're noticing that sales are starting to turn down. So I think it's the new startups and separate product producers that are more adept at seeing the change and following the trend. You've also got things like, you know, in the old days, people were out at the pub if they wanted to be social. Now you have things like coffee and tea houses, which are open late, and you don't necessarily have to be drinking to be out with your friends. So I think all this is kind of positive. It's also probably better for people's finances if they're not drinking as much alcohol, because it's a terrible expense. So, you know, again, part of all these themes probably tied together.
Well, they also boosted the penalties for drinking and driving in Canada. And it was interesting to note that Surrey, the second largest city in BC, did not have one reported case of impaired driving New Year's Eve.
There you go. I think it's I think it was smart when they lowered it from the blood alcohol down to 0.5 from 0.8, because it does make a person more concerned, you know, that they, you know, I think there's generally a sense of concern that people might be over even if they had a drink or two. And I think the rise of things like Uber and Lyft and public transportation has just made people a lot more less likely to take the risk, and I think that's very positive. So absolutely, also in the younger generation, I find there's a very low tolerance for anyone that is, you know, considering drinking and driving. Certainly in my kids' peer group, it's not even a thought. Everyone either stays over when there's a party, or, you know, has a designated driver, or takes a shared transport. So I think this is all positive. Unfortunately, of course, Jim, deaths on the road have gone up, and that's because of distracted driving. So it's almost like, you know, drunk driving is still, you know, high driving and all that is going to always be a theme, and there's going to be always people that are abusing drugs and taking other people's lives in their hands by driving with those inebriations. However, the one that needs a real new push or attention and higher penalties, of course, is this distracted driving or texting and using your phone, because it is literally killing us.
Well, what about all the touch screens they're putting into cars now? You got to take your eyes off the road to run anything. You can't just do it by feel.
That's true. You do have to look to touch a screen. So, you know, they probably have to evolve that technology as well. But there's, you know, there's lots of reasons to be distracted if you'll allow it. And ultimately, I think it comes back to the responsibility has to be on the driver. But also, in many cases, you know, we could have an evolution of technology where things just don't work when a car is in motion, full stop. And that could be part of the solution, too. If people don't have the personal discipline, then, you know, we do have the ability to have things like cell phones that won't work unless you're fully stopped.
Do you have any ideas on Brexit right now and how that might affect Canada?
I think it's a hell of a distraction. I think this whole, the whole government shutdown in the U.S. and the Brexit stuff that's never ending and may now indeed go past March because, you know, we've been at, they've been at it 2 years already since the referendum trying to come up with a way to do this. And it really is a sideshow that's distracting people from a lot of more really fundamental issues. And I'm not saying that it's not awful for people that are furloughed and not getting paid in the U.S. I mean, that's outrageous. The thing is, they've already agreed to spend that money. It's not like anyone's, you know, the government is already spent the money. Now it's just a question of releasing the funds to pay their obligations. So it's really kind of a unfair standoff or a pointless standoff in many ways, but there you go. And in Brexit, the same thing. I think there's no question they could negotiate a new arrangement for leaving the EU, but the problem is always this. The vested interests never want a threat to their business model. So they're always pushing for adherence to the status quo. And change requires breaking and moving forward from past norms. And I think that's desperately needed in the world today. And so we need to get on with the bigger stuff, though. You know, we need to get on with reconfiguring the power grid. We need to get on with figuring out ways to take carbon out of the atmosphere, transforming the food system. You know, a new report came out this week from a band of scientists who are looking at how to feed, you know, coming up 8 billion people on the world, as well as not totally decimate our natural environment so that our health can stay intact and we can move forward with the species. And they said, ultimately, you know, we have to go towards a highly plant-based diet. We have to transform this whole big food stuff that sells people frozen junk they throw in the freezer and then throw in the oven is not the way to feed people. It's not the way to use our resources. And we can do it. Here's a proposal. You know, there's proposals coming out every week about how to transform substantive systems that will matter for the long-term future of the economy and of life on the earth. And instead, we're spending almost all our time focused on sideshows like Brexit and shutdowns of government instead of actually getting the news flow onto the things that matter. So that is definitely a cost of this.
Danielle, thank you so much for chatting with us.
Hey, thank you, Jim.
My guest has been Danielle Park, editor of the popular blog Juggling Dynamite. You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio. Find us on Twitter at HowStreet, our YouTube channel, Talk Digital Network. If you have any questions for Danielle or any of our other guests, you can send them to info@HowStreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard. Thanks for listening.
Comments made on HowStreet.com Radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. HowStreet.com Radio is a production of HowStreet Media Incorporated.